I mean, I think I did a dozen recording sessions with different players, and I eventually settled on really trying to work with just one musician covering all the instruments as much as I could. So I had one flute player covering all the different flute family members, one bassoonist on bassoon and contrabassoon. Sorry, no sarusophone. one player covering all the clarinet family from E-flat all the way down to contrabassoon. Contrabass clarinet, and except for one guy who specialized in basset horn, which you really kind of need a specialist to make that sound right. And I sort of ran into a bit of a wall with the oboe family, because it was just like different opportunities presenting themselves whenever possible. I had one guy on oboe and English horn who did most of that, and then I had to have another person come in to play the oboe d'amore, and then I had to have yet another person to come in to play hecklephone, and I thought, okay, well, you know, that's all the hecklephone I could record. The hecklephone that I was borrowing was not in the greatest shape, and the player was really struggling with it, and it's, you know, it's hard to get a perfect hecklephone read. It has to be slightly smaller than a bassoon, or you can use a smaller bassoon read, but it's just not an ideal thing. And then, just right at the last minute, I heard that there was a lupophone in town. And if you're not aware of what that is a bass oboe that goes all the way down to a low F. So you can reach that low F that's in Alpen Symphony by Richard Strauss. So it was in town, and the only chance that I had to record the player was to actually just go to the New Zealand Symphony Orchestra rehearsal and just talk her into playing all of her excerpts during the break. So there we are on the stage, and you'll see it in the if you don't want to buy the course yet, you can actually just preview it on my channel, Orchestration Online, which has got the entire video with all the Strauss excerpts. And that actually, that went viral. Don't ask me why. 53,000 people want to watch about the bass oboe. Okay. Awesome.
There's not that many videos about bass oboe.
That's true. And there are not that many recordings of the lupophone, so it was nice to provide that. And, I mean, still, it's a situation where pretty much anybody who is tasked with playing bass oboe really has a big challenge ahead of them. And it's rare when you find a specialist, sort of like the basset horn player, where they play it all the time. They've got a good read. They've got a good relationship with their instrument. The instrument's in good repair. I mean, you can have an instrument in fairly good repair, and then it can sit on a shelf for like 7 years, and then it just gets pulled right off of the shelf, and somebody's got to play the planets with it, and it can, you know, it has changed in that time just sitting there. So it's one of those problems with auxiliaries in general, and yet that is what I wanted to put in these courses. So there's contrabass clarinet, there's there's E flat clarinet, and so on. Bass oboe, like I mentioned before, bass flute, the true bass in C, and so on. So I felt that those were really important to include so that people could get the, not just the scope of what it sounds like and why it would be an interesting texture or timbre to introduce into your score, but also what are the consequences of scoring that? You know, what will you not be able to do? You know, and usually, sometimes it'll just get cut out, or like its notes will get given to some other player. They'll just sort of split it up. So it's just good to know, you know, what is available when and why, and that's all in there.